how to deal with manifolds, you know how to deal with the case of general relativity in which we imposed our conditions, torsion-free and metric compatibility. You know how to parallelly transport vectors around. You know what is the meaning of the geodesic equation. So you know a lot of stuff now, okay? Now that I give you that, which is only about mathematics, because I'm making constant links to physics, because we are talking about physics here, but it is purely mathematics, okay? You're purely about manifolds. Here, we are going to make some more direct connection to physics. I'm going to show you the connection to Newtonian gravity. And afterward, we are going to apply a variational approach, and you will see how the Christoffel symbols will pop up magically. Okay, you assume a free particle in some generic space-time. You assume no force applied to the particle. Variational approach, in the end, the Christoffel symbol, tuck, pops up. Okay? Magic. Good. So, let's get started, and let's start very simple. As I already told you, that geodesic equation, the u mu over the lambda equal to zero, it's equivalent to a straight line. How do we see it? Because if we look to the very same case, but in space-time, you know that this equation is telling you that dx, d square, d 2x over d lambda square is equal to zero. What does it mean? There is no acceleration. That's the trajectory of a straight line. So you understand that this is just a generalization. Right? So this supports the statement that I did before. And you know that particles follow a straight line when they are free. But now, through this generalization, we don't speak anymore about free particle, or if you wish, is a free particle, but now it's better to speak about free falling particle. Are we dealing with a force? Well, let's write the geodesic equation in the form that I gave you before. So that with the u nu over the lambda is equal to 1/2 the nu g alpha beta u alpha u beta. Before there was a gamma here, but it was also here. There are dummy indices, I'm just free to change it. So that's the expression we had before. Now let's compare it with the Lorentz force. That we have in electrodynamics, written in a covariant way. We have m the u nu over the tau, so the proper time, equal to q over c, f mu nu, and then we have u nu. Mu, sorry. Can you see the similarity? Look at it. Let's take now this guy. And let's call it sorry, let's, yes, up to here. So let's call it Smiley. No, alpha. Okay? Doesn't look like this guy here. We have exactly the same structure. So is it a force? No, it looks like a force. But it's not, okay? So that's why people got kind of deceived for ages, because they had the impression that we're dealing with a force, a conservative force to which you can associate a potential, and you can describe the force as the gradient of that potential, but it's not. It's a free falling particle. It's a free particle in a curved space. But still, it looks like a force. You see, it has exactly the same structure, the equation, as the Lorentz force that describes electrodynamics. Look a crucial difference here. The acceleration of a particle, we have the mass, inertial. On this side, we have Q, the charge of the particle. That tells you what is the strength of the interaction of this particle with the field in which it is embedded in. Okay? Here there is not. Why? Equivalence principle. M and M is a inertial phenomena. The mass drops. Okay? Isn't it nice? I always find it nice. Then, let's try the way around. Let's start now from Newtonian mechanics. And Newtonian gravity. So, how do we describe things in what is the equation of motion in Newtonian mechanics? Well, we have the acceleration of a particle along the eth direction. Now, E is 1, 2, 3, because Newton was living in a three-dimensional space plus time. And then we have the potential in the direction E, and phi is use the same letter I used before. So phi is the potential of the gravitational force. Now, let's stress it. 1, 2, and 3. That's Newtonian mechanics. Let's now try to reshape this equation and make it look like the geodesic equation. So let's keep x dot dot e, plus, if we look at the geodesic equation, then we have the fact that we have a u and u multiplied together. So what I can do is to keep our phi, divide it by c squared, and multiply twice by C. These two clearly drops. I haven't done anything. They are identical. Why I multiply this here? Am I crazy? Well, a bit, but let's see why. So let's take our four velocity, U, nu, and what are the components? We have a gamma factor, then we have C, and then we have the x dot direction, no, only the space component, so let's use E. Let's assume a non-relativistic case in which beta is way smaller with respect to 1. The gamma factor turns into a 1, I mean it's approximately 1, therefore let's see x dot E. So what is now x0 is equal to c. Now let's continue with this guy. What is this equal to? It's equal to x dot dot e plus di phi over c square x zero equal to zero. Now it starts to look like the geodesic equation. Because I can now call this object delta e phi over c square as a Christoffel symbol. You see? And now this expression looks like that. X dot dot e plus e zero zero x zero equal to zero. And as you see, I haven't done anything at all. Because what I did was multiply and divide by c squared. And then what I did was to call this guy like that. Okay? I just give it a name. As I did with the smiley before, I can call it a Christoffel symbol. And that's what we get. Where are the other terms, you may ask? Well, there are assumptions here. Because here, implicit here, we're assuming a weak field. Then we are also assuming a non-relativistic particle. So non-relativistic motion. Plus, we are also asking for a static metric. That's kind of implicit up there. You could have also the phi varying, but it's not that crucial, but these are the assumptions that we have. And whenever we have this assumption, that's what we end up with. So if we would start with the geodesic equation, as we are going to do, and we impose this condition, we arrive at this construction. And you see, they are one-to-one, spot-on Newtonian mechanics. Okay, so you can go one way or the other way. Now, look at the parameterization here. There is an x dot. X dot, what does it mean? The x over the t. And before I was using always this lambda. And then I also told you, look, lambda can be the tau. Now you start to see the link. And remember that between here and here, there is a gamma factor in between. But we are assuming non-relativistic motions, therefore gamma is similar to 1. Okay? Therefore, as well, in the last equation, I could use tau instead of the time. Then I told you, then we can further notice that I can have another parameterization of t, which is a plus b lambda, a new time. I can do that. If I use that, if I use lambda, well, sorry, let's wait the way around, it's clear. If I use another parameter, which is a linear combination of the time, the equation of motion is not going to change. And the reason is very simple, because we have double derivatives with respect to times, and this gives us a time, so a factor of b to the 2 in our expressions. But the potential scales as b to the minus 2. And the 2 cancel. That's why the equation of motion is going to be the same. That's weird. Why, not quite. This is a time. I can rescale my timing. If I tell you that 1 second is from here to here, or from here to here, I'm just rescaling the time, but the equation of motion must be the same. What is this? It's a time shift. If I start to count here from 2022, or I define age zero now, it doesn't matter. The equation of motion is going to be the same. Okay, so you see the mathematics. Mathematically, the two terms cancel. Here we are dealing with derivatives. The constant is completely irrelevant. And you see the connection between tau and lambda, and you can see the connection between between tau and the time in with respect to this context. Okay? One last word. Let's see, again, a connection between the geodesic equation and mechanics, Newtonian mechanics. So, first axiom. If you have a free particle, it will move inertially. So the geodesic equation is expressing the first axiom of Newtonian mechanics in a curved space-time. You have a free particle, you are dealing with an inertial motion. Again, now inertial motion has to be changed with free falling. But the link of free falling is to the first axiom of Newton. Then, what is the second axiom? Well, that's the fact that if you have a force applied, then there is going to be an acceleration. Mx dot dot e equal to fe, which is equal to minus the gradient in the direction, let's give the index up, of phi. Okay, that's Newtonian mechanics, therefore the index up or down doesn't matter. Okay, good. Now what we are doing is that we are bringing this guy on the other side. Which stands for the free-falling object. We removed the force, we brought it on this side, and we associate it to the space-time. That's what we did. Then there is action and reaction, which is unchanged. And whenever you have a particle, you can always, a free particle, now for us it's going to be a free particle, we can add an external force. Okay, the force would add there as a source term. Therefore, we could have the equation of motion of that is going to be given by the geodesic equation up there of a free particle, and then you can add plus the term given by the Lorentz force. We would have a particle moving in a gravitational field, meaning in a curved space-time, and the Lorentz force, so an electromagnetic field acting upon the particle. Okay, you can add other source terms, of course. So GR is there, it tells you it's a free particle, and then you can add on top of it all the forces that you want. Okay, taking care, always remembering that the space-time is curved, and also electrodynamics is affected. Because in electrodynamics, when you have a scalar product, like up there, you see, there is always the metric involved. And there, usually, if you study electrodynamics in a covariant way, nu mu nu, the Minkowski metric was assumed. So when you do this trick, you need to modify electrodynamics as well, because you don't have any more nu mu nu, you don't have any more the Minkowski metric, but you have a generic metric, the metric that is produced by the gravitational field, okay, which is associated to gravity. Okay, we will give a look into that as well. So we will see also how electrodynamics is affected by the fact that we don't have the Minkowski metric, but a generic metric, okay? So, let's move on, and let's dig in a bit more, because what I showed you was just some parallel, so I showed you that the geodesic equation looks like a force. It's not, but it looks like a force. That's why we perceive it as a force. I showed you that also if you go the way around, you can re-express the Newtonian equations of motion for phi. Actually, it's any conservative force, because I'm telling you that that's the potential of gravity, but it could be anything. It's just a scalar potential. So whatever scalar potential, given these assumptions, you can write it in terms of a Christoffel symbol, okay? That's funny enough. Then I showed you the connection of lambda to time, but this is again not, you shouldn't be completely convinced, because I started with the time in first place, and then I made just an association to what we studied before, but it didn't pop up, okay? So what I'm going to do now is to start with a variational approach, which is fully covariant. And I'm going to do something that we've already seen, because I did this approach for a free particle in special relativity. And what we did? Well, I defined an action, S, for a free particle, which is mc squared, and then that's the integral of the tau. We have seen that, right? We have an action, you have your Lagrangian, which is inside your action, and the Lagrangian, it tells you how the particle is going to behave. Then what we did, what is tau? Well, let's just write the expression for, well, there is a minus, yeah, there is the minus. Is what? Is the square root of minus g, and I use the mu nu, the x mu, the x nu. Right? That's the tau. Remember, we have a you assume a frame in which the dx for the space components are equal to zero. There is only the t, you bring the c on the other side, and on the other side you have only that. Okay? Divided c. That cancels with this guy here. Okay? Just give a look back if you forgot it, go back to the definition of the proper time, and you will see that the tau is actually equal to this guy here. Okay? This is expressed for the rest frame of a particle, and this is for a generic frame. And notice that, well, I'm still dealing with Minkowski space, so I'm assuming the Minkowski metric at the moment. Okay? It is a bit. Let's make it bigger like this. Can't write anymore. Okay, Minkowski metric. But now what I can do, I can divide it by the tau, I can divide it by the tau, so this is a the tau square that I must bring outside, with the square root gives me the tau. Now you see that I have the same representation, but I have a sort of an action which is based on the metric. Flat space and this is a free particle. That's the action for a free particle. What I'm going to do now, it's obvious to you, so what I'm going to do is to abandon the Minkowski metric and just get any metric, where the metric is kept fixed. So we are going to do exactly the same business, and we are going to apply the variational approach. So we are going to have our S, which is now equal to the guy there. So we have a minus MC, and then we have minus G mu nu, the U mu nu, because the X over the tau is U, is the four velocity now. You see, now I'm using tau. And then 1/2 and the tau. Then what we do, we apply the variational approach. So we apply this is a constant, this is a linear integral, therefore the variation can be brought inside. Because we are looking for the equation of motion, which is given by the condition that S equal to zero. We are minimizing the action. That's why it's called least action principle. Okay? Good. So now we do something simple. Remember that this is a functional derivative, because we're not making the integral of S with respect to some direction or with respect to direction like the X, the Y, or whatever, okay? It's a functional derivative that gives us the path. So we are varying the path of a trajectory between the point A and the point B. That's something you must know. So what we do is to look this trajectory, if we are in flat space, we are varying not this point or this point, but the entire trajectory, and we are looking for the minimal path, which in flat space is a straight line. Okay? That's what the minimization we are doing. This is just a reminder of mechanics. So what we do now, as I said, we apply the least action principle. Therefore, we have minus MC integral. There is always an AB, I will not copy, but it's always between two fixed points. Then we just apply the derivative. Therefore, we have 1/2, and then we have minus G mu nu, U mu, U nu, minus 1/2. Times the derivative of what is here, but G, we kept it fixed. Therefore, I can as well write it as, which letter I used, mu, as mu, mu, right? That's exactly what I had before. We have a product. Let's do it here. Let's restore this one. Let's maybe mu, mu, G, mu, mu, so that you have everything. So you see that, let me make it shorter, u, nu, no, you use mu, u, mu, minus 1/2 times the derivative of what I have here. There is a minus that we have to keep, which cancel with this one. And then we have a factor of 2, because we have a product. And the two are symmetric, so you can flip the two. And we get the 2u mu, and then the variation of u mu in the tau. Yes. Well, now we have the variation. And, well, actually, first, let's notice this guy. What is equal? What is u mu, u mu? That's the four velocity. What is the modulus of the four velocities? Minus c squared. That's why it is minus, because we have the square root of c squared. 1 over c squared, over the square root of minus 1 squared, therefore it's c squared that cancels with this guy here. Okay? Because all of that together is c to the minus 2. C to the minus 1, because there is the square root. And it's going to cancel with this guy here, with the 2 here. Okay? Good. Then we have this guy, so we need to investigate the variation of mu. For the u mu is nothing but the is associated. We need to keep in mind that we are in a curved space-time, therefore we are using the covariant derivative. The u beta mu, and then the tau. Because the variation is done with respect to the spatial time, to the proper time. Sorry, the variation for the u beta. Yes. Then we just expressed this guy explicitly. Again, I'm not assuming any specific connection, just for any connection. This cancel. Okay, good. Therefore, we are left with M. And then let me copy for sake of speed, U mu, the beta U mu, plus the fine connection beta gamma, U gamma, delta X beta, the tau. So you see what I did? I just cancel TC with TC, and then I just expressed explicitly the variation of U mu, which is based on the covariance derivative, which is this guy here. So this guy here is this variation of U mu. Then what I just do is I can just bring it inside, which give us the u mu times the derivative with respect to beta, and this is going to give us the variation. It's going to give us the directional, is associated to a directional derivative. And we have m integral of the u beta over the lambda plus mu beta gamma u gamma. There is a u mu that I missed. U mu, which is that one, yes. Which is u mu. Yeah. Okay. And then we have the variation of x beta, which is coming from there. And then we have the tau. How does it look like? But we're applying the least action principle. Therefore, this guy must be equal to zero and must be valid for any variation. It means that this guy must be equal to zero. Boom, geodesic equation. Therefore, the equation of motion is equal to the geodesic equation. Equation of motion of a free particle. And now you see the connection between the lambda I was using before and tau. And again, from the variational approach, you can see that lambda can be just a linear combination of tau. Here, we set A equal to 0 and B equal to 1. The way of writing like this is called a fine parameter. So any lambda that obeys this linear combination with respect to time is called a fine parameter, and we are free to use it for our own convenience. And this sort of representation keeps unchanged the equation of motion, and you can try it yourself by plugging it in into the very beginning of our derivation. So again, here you see from a mechanical point of view, by applying the variational approach, we get the equation of motion, which is the geodesic equation. And from free particle, we need to change to free falling. But it's a matter of terminology, right? You see exactly what we did. We just changed from a free particle. Instead of the Minkowski metric, we used G. Any metric. Okay? This is nice. But we can do even better. I will just make it short, because we don't need to go through the mathematics. But I'm going to derive exactly the same expression, but I will not, for the variation, I will not use this shortcut, in which I already implied, I already use the definition of our covariance derivative, and I forced in an affine connection. Okay? You can do without that. You can do without that by letting G, and look at the variation with respect to G as well. Let me cancel this. I will give you just the key steps. The rest you can find it in the notes. There is nothing magic with it, and I literally did a step-by-step derivation. There is no, I didn't let anything hidden. Important is the concept. Whoa. I was going to fall. Okay, now it's pure. We have not even used the covariance derivative. We even give away this concept now. But we do exactly the same. So what we do, I just give you the starting minus mc integral of the variation of minus g mu nu. Then we have u mu u nu 1/2. In the tau, which is exactly what we did before. Okay? But now the variation, we let it run also on our G. Therefore, you see, I have tac, tac. I'm going to do, you understand, I'm going to apply the product rule. We get our usual 1/2 minus G mu nu u mu u nu. Minus 1/2, exactly as before. And now what I'm going to do is to look for minus variation of G mu nu times u mu u nu plus G mu nu, there is the minus, what is it? Then the u mu, u nu, and so on. Okay? So that's the difference of what I did before. Instead of hiding, because I was hiding the, because I, the metric was hidden in the scalar product between u mu and u mu, you see, when I did that trick, I have been hiding the metric inside the scalar product. You see? I hide it, and then I had to kind of pull it out by using the explicit expression for the covariance. Now I'm not doing this anymore. I leave it free like that. Therefore, I get these derivatives of the metric into play. Then there is just, you just reshuffle a little bit the equation. There is nothing magic going on. So we just do, we solve one part. One part of this integral is solved by partial integration. And then there is just some reshuffling of indices. Of the dummy variables. And at the end, you find the computations in the lecture notes. You end up with that. With this expression that again must be valid for any variation of x mu, which means that this guy must be equal to zero. Looks weird. But look carefully, because this guy has symmetries that reflects on this term. And there is a factor of two here. And this factor of two can be turned around. So we have, this is equal to, all of this is equal to minus. Therefore, we can change sign. We change sign to these terms. Therefore, we have a minus, plus, plus. Okay, I don't need to go further in explaining that. And when you do that, you basically get the x squared alpha, the tau squared, plus 1/2 g mu nu, that we can pull together, to the gamma g mu nu, minus the mu g gamma nu. The x gamma, the x nu, over the tau, over the tau. Which is the geodesic equation. And this guy are the Christoffel symbols. Assuming metric compatibility and torsion free. It looks a little bit different. Remember that in the Christoffel symbols there are three terms. There is a derivative plus another derivative minus another derivative of the metric. But here there is a factor of two. And there is a factor of two, because if you look at the Christoffel symbols, they are the same whenever they are applied to a symmetric term. Because we have two dummy variables, gamma and mu, and you can, instead of writing like this with a factor of two, you can write it also with nu free, with the indices flipped. These guys are the Christoffel symbols. They just popped up. And this is even nicer than the approach before that I did, okay? So this was to superstress the fact that the geodesic equation can be derived also from a variational approach, which is what you do whenever you have a Lagrangian at ends to study the evolution of the system. In this case, the system is a free particle. That's the assumption we did. You see, exactly as we did in special relativity, I took out a generic metric, and then we just applied the variational approach up to the end, in which the equation of motions turned out to be the geodesic equation. Then I did it also in this other way, which if you wish is pure, because in this trick I use the affine connection. That if you want, here is a bit more general, because the affine connection, there is any connection, so it's a little bit more general. Here what I did instead is to live with the metric, make it explicitly in this term, something that I didn't before, because the metric was hidden here and I kept it hidden. And when you apply the derivative, the variational approach, you get this slightly complicated equation with respect to before, but you realize that actually all of that is associated, are the Christoffel symbols. Okay? In the lecture notes, you find all the steps line by line. But this is the idea. Isn't this nice? Okay? You see now the connection between lambda and the proper time? You see why we are free from a mechanical point of view to use an affine parametrization like this one. We are free to make this change, and the equation of motion is always the same. Now you must be convinced. Okay? Good. Thank you very much, and see you next week.